to sell. There's more information on the back. If you have questions about that, talk to Janet. And then you'll note that there's dates for summer organ recitals coming up around the Fond du Lac and greater area. With that, I invite you to stand as you are able, as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. Let us now take time to think about those things that separate us from God. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God, you are the tree of life, offering shelter to all the world. Graft us into yourself and nurture our growth, that we may bear your truth and love to those in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. You may be seated.
The first reading is from the second chapter of Acts, beginning with the 14th verse. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know. This man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power." The word of the Lord.
Our first hymn today is "I Love to Tell the Story." I know it's one of my favorite. You might end up noticing today I placed hymns written by all women, which there's plenty of others interspersed, but today just happened to be a day with all hymns written by women. Arabella Catherine Hankey, nicknamed Kate, was born in Clapham, England, into a family that was part of the Clapham sect, which, take note of that fact, you'll hear it again. It was a sect of wealthy Anglican evangelicals who lived nearby and were part of its parish church. They shared different convictions of morality, mission, good works, and the abolition of the slave trade. Kate Hankey devoted her life to this kind of work, especially teaching Bible classes to both rich and poor girls in London, visiting people in the hospital, and foreign missions to which she contributed time and money. So she wrote this poem around 1866 when she was weak and weary after an illness. It might have been stimulated by a sermon by C.H. Spurgeon, which was delivered in 1862, called "The Old, Old Story." Her poem is in two parts. The first part of the hymn is dated around January 29th, 1866, and was called "The Story Wanted." And the second part was apparently dated November 18th, 1866, so a number of months later, and called "The Story Told." The poem has circulated in various versions, so there's different reports about it. There's also some who, and so there's also differing thoughts about where the hymn comes from. Many find it in that second part, but there's a few who say it's in the first part. And there's also versions printed in three parts instead of two, where it's, and it's without her name attached to it, of "The Story Wanted" with 8 stanzas, "The Story Told" with 41 stanzas, and "The Story Welcomed" with 6 stanzas. But but in a copy of the old story by Kate Henke, which is either from 1867 or 1871. We're not sure. Found in the library at Union Seminary in New York City, the hymn comes at the end of a 74 stanza poem, which may be from 1872. The hymn appears by itself with 8 stanzas. And so there's also with this poem varying thoughts on the poem itself. Some regard it as very accessible and helpful and compelling language, because when you read the hymn itself, it does actually give the Christian story. Others regard it as trivializing the Christian story into a fantasy nursery rhyme. The 39 stanza part of the 74 stanza poem tells the story, whether one likes it or not. But the hymn that we have actually avoids the story. We talk about the story. We hear things like unseen things above, and Jesus' love is understood as what satisfies my longings, but the story itself is never told. It's just amusing, they're musing on telling that story. The tune itself is named Henke, named for the author of the hymn, which is published together with the text in 1869, which, to note, it was written by William G. Fisher, different than William E. Fisher, who has written other tunes to other hymns. And William Gustavus Fisher wrote over 200 gospel tunes. So let us sing the first verse of I Love to Tell the Story.
The second reading is from the 6th chapter of the Gospel of John, beginning at the 35th verse. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. Everything that the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. This is indeed the will of my Father, that all who see the Son and believe in him may have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." The word of the Lord.
Charlotte Elliott was born in Clapham, England. Sound familiar? It's the same place that Kate Henke was born a number of years later. So Charlotte also was part of this Clapham sect to which Henke's family was also part of. In 1821, Charlotte was sick, and that affected the rest of her life. And so she moved to Brighton for the rest of her life. For 40 years, she corresponded with the Genevan evangelist and text and tune writer Henry A. Cesare Millan, who helped her with her spiritual life and through her suffering, and in spite of her pain, to write her religious poetry and hymns. Now, Charlotte Elliott wrote this hymn in 1834. At the time, she lived with her brother Henry Venn Elliott, an evangelical Anglican vicar and also a hymn writer. They were having a bazaar, selling things to build a school at St. Mary's Hall, Brighton, but she was too ill to help. So as it says, Charlotte had lain awake all night, oppressed with the sense of uselessness, tossed about with many a doubt. While everyone was at Westfield Lodge, was out and busy over the bazaar, she lay in greater misery than ever. And determined to fight it out then and there, she took pen to hand and wrote this hymn. In 1835, it was printed first in a leaflet and the following year in a hymn book. The verse given to it in the hymn book was John 6, verse 37. Him that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. When printed in the hymn book, there were six stanzas. The seventh was then included with a different hymn book printed in 1836. And what we print in our red Evangelical Lutheran worship hymnals is the first, third, fifth, and sixth stanzas. Now, just the tune is Woodworth, written by William B. Bradbury. It appeared first in a collection he edited with Thomas Hastings called the Mendelssohn Collection, where it had been paired with another text by Elizabeth Scott called The God of Love Will Sure Indulge. And then later was added to this text. So let us sing verses 1 and 4 of Just As I Am.
The third reading is from the fourth chapter of the Gospel of Mark, beginning at the 35th verse. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this man that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The word of the Lord.
Our next hymn is "Lord, Take My Hand." The hymn by was written by Julie Van Huysman. Her full name, Julie Katerina Huysman, was born in Latvia. Her father was a town councilor, which made him part of the Russian aristocracy, resulting in the family name being changed to Von Huysman. Though shy and not physically strong, Julie was bright. She studied privately, even though migraine headaches made things difficult. She planned to marry a theology graduate who went to East Africa as a missionary. Yet when she arrived in Africa to join him, she found out he had died of tropical fever. So she returned to Latvia. There she was a governess for 14 years, which is when she wrote this hymn. She cared for her father, who died in 1864, stayed with her younger sister, who was an organist in an English church in southwestern France, and then lived with her and two other sisters in St. Petersburg, Russia, where the oldest sister was the director of a girls' school. Huysman worked with the poor, wrote poetry, sometimes conceiving poems while she was awake at night with migraines, and then writing them down the next morning. Personally, I don't know how she could remember them through the night to write them the next morning. While she was caring for her father, Pastor Gustav Nock saw her poetry and asked to publish it. She agreed to let the pastor publish it as long as it was anonymous and that the profits went to a school and orphanage in Hong Kong. And so they were published in 3 volumes, first by the pastor, and then his son published a 4th volume. This hymn, "Lord, Take My Hand," was published in 1862. In 1912, Rudolf A. John made a translation of it that began, "Take thou my hand and lead me." Then in 1925, Hermann Bruckner made a translation that began, "Oh, take my hand, dear father." Then it kind of became a mashup of the 2 versions, Bruckner's first stanza, substantially altered, along with John's 2nd and 3rd, with shades of his 1st, formed the basis of the version that we had in our previous hymnal, the Lutheran Book of Worship, the green one. And our Evangelical Lutheran Worship hymnal uses it with 1 minor alteration, that in stanza 3, the 3rd line, a "then" become, using "then" instead of "and." Just a slight change. So let us sing verses 1 and 2.
Thank you.
The fourth reading is from the second chapter of Galatians, beginning with the 16th verse. Yet we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus, so that we might be justified by faith in Christ, and not by doing the works of the law, because no one will be justified by the works of the law. But if in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For through the law I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. The word of the Lord.
Our last hymn for today is a Blessed Assurance. This hymn has been called the Archetypal Gospel Song. Now, Fanny Crosby wrote it in a response to the tune. Phoebe Knapp wrote the tune, played it for Crosby, and asked her what it meant. And Crosby responded with this hymn. It and the tune were included in J.R. Sweeney's Gems of Praise in 1873 and in another hymnal in 1887. It became part of Dwight Moody's and Ira Sankey's revivals in England and then in the United States and later of Billy Graham's Crusades. Now the tune, Assurance, as we heard, is composed by Phoebe P. Knapp. She grew up as a musically gifted child in a Methodist perfectionist home with the wealth and privilege of New York City's Lower Manhattan Society. When she was 16, she married Joseph Fairchild Knapp, a lithographer who made a fortune with his company and became president of the Metropolitan Life Insurance Company. The couple lived in a mansion in Brooklyn, where they were active members of St. John's Methodist Episcopal Church and where in the Sunday school he was superintendent and she used her musical abilities. He died in 1891 and she put her fortune to benevolent uses. Her son Joseph Palmer Knapp became the president of the Cromwell Collier Publishing Company. A close friend and collaborator of Fanny Crosby, she wrote over 500 gospel hymns and tunes. So let us sing Blessed Assurance.
Thank you.
us join together in professing our faith found in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended.
We come before the Triune God to pray for our communities, ourselves, and our world. Nourish your faithful people through gifts of word and worship. Guide the church in listening to and interpreting your message of grace for this time and place in history. In your wisdom, lead us in expanding the reach of your love. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Nature sings your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. Sustain the holy rhythms of creation, days and seasons, hibernation and activity, phases of the moon and tides of the sea. Let these patterns assure us of your constancy. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You raise the lowly and humble those in high regard. Raise up all who are victims of marginalization, discrimination, and hate. As we anticipate Juneteenth, banish white supremacy and bigotry from the hearts of your people and remove the inclination towards anger and violence. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Tend to all who journey by faith and who wait with patience for the fulfillment of your healing promises. Grant perseverance to people doing physical and occupational therapy, people living with mobility concerns, and people facing chronic pain. We especially pray for healing and comfort for those on the prayer list. Merciful God, as you have loved us, so let us love one another. Empower fathers, stepfathers, grandfathers, adoptive fathers, and chosen fathers to embody this gift of love for their children. Where these relationships are strained or broken, bring your comfort and peace. Merciful God, receive our prayer. With gratitude, we remember the saints who are now at home with you. Plant seeds of their wisdom and witness in our hearts, that we grow in faith until we join them in your heavenly dwelling. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Receive our prayers, O God, and come quickly to our aid through the power and the spirit of the love of Jesus Christ. Amen.
At this time, I invite you to be seated as we enter time of a healing service. The ministry of Jesus invites us to new life in God and with each other. We proclaim the good news that God desires us to be healthy and one in the body of Christ. You are invited to offer yourselves whatever your sickness of spirit, mind, or body, and receive a sign of healing and wholeness in the name of the Triune God. Sisters and brothers, siblings in Christ, I invite you forward as you are comfortable to come and receive a sign of healing and wholeness in the name of the Triune God. If you are not comfortable with coming forward, I will offer the prayer to you after those who do come forward. I invite you to come forward now.
Thank you.
For those who did not come forward but would still like to receive the blessing, I invite you to place your hand over your heart and hear those words. In the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, may you be strengthened and filled with God's grace, that you may know the healing power of the Spirit. Amen. In remembrance of your baptism, I now invite you all to make the sign of the cross on your forehead. Child of God, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Let us pray. God of mercy, source of all healing, we give you thanks for your gifts of strength and life, and especially for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, the health and salvation of the world. Help us by your Holy Spirit to feel your power in our lives and to know your eternal love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May the God of all consolation bless you in every way and grant you hope in all the days of your life. May God restore you to health and grant you salvation. May God fill your heart with peace and lead you to eternal life. Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. I invite you to share a sign of peace with one another.
Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
Our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels of the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, the new promise in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. And coming forward for communion, you'll take two lines down the center. Me and the assisting minister will have bread. There is gluten-free available if you need. The communion assistants have wine on the outside and white grape juice in the center in individual cups. Know that this table does not belong to me. This table does not belong to this congregation. This table, this meal belongs to God. And the table does not have limited seating. This table is expansive. And God wants you to come as you are, as who you are, to this table of God's love. So come, Christ is at the table with more than enough for all. Come. I invite you to stand as you are able. Now the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace unto everlasting life.
Amen. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Gracious God, loving all your family with a mother's tender care, as you sent the angel to feed Elijah with heavenly bread, assist us in this ministry in which we are sent forth. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those to whom we bring this sacrament, that through the body and blood of your Son, we all may know the comfort of your abiding presence. Amen. Receive this blessing. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever.
Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.
Thanks be.